in production automation project, I have this Siemens S7 how to. And in there I have the S7 PID. I have the old version of S7-300, and then I have the current PLC that we are using in the lab at the moment, S7-1200 PID Compact. And this image is from the manual from the old S7-300 PLC, but it shows some things very well, so I will use this image. So this is basic structure of the PID control. The measurements are here on the left. The naming of the inputs and outputs is not quite the same as in the current version. So for example, PV in. In the current S7-1200 PLC, this input is noted as input. So it's just plain input. PV is an acronym from process value. So it's a measurement. And the other input for measurement, process value, is PVPER in here. And in S7-12000, the name of this input is input per peripheral. So these two inputs are both meant for connecting the measurement input for the PID. The difference is that the input PV in is connected straight to the calculation of the error signal. So that's the difference between measurement and the set point. Set point is in engineering units. So for example, if you have a level control scaling from 0 to 2 meters, the set point could be, for example, 1.6 meters. So it's not some arbitrary 0 to 27,000 integer. It really is an engineering unit input. And if we make a calculation between engineering unit and engineering unit, that will make some sense. But if you connect the analog input from the PLC straight in here, then you will have calculation between engineering units and some random integer number. So you have to convert the analog input value, which is between 0 and 27,648. You have to convert it to engineering units, and these two blocks are for that purpose. But anyway, you can select whether you use the scaled input, meaning that you have to do the scaling yourself, or you can connect the analog input straight to the PID controller and let the controller do the scaling for you. And how can you do the scaling yourself? I have a page for that. Scaling of analog inputs. So you use a normalizing function block and a scaling function block. And the inputs for the normalizing function block are, first of all, the measurement from the analog input signal. And if you use the default addresses, the analog input number 1 will be at address IW64. And I have given it the tag LI100 in here. So the value input is the measurement straight from the analog input. And the two other inputs are scale minimum and scale maximum. And the scale of the analog input is fixed from 0 to 27,648. So this value, this 0 and this 27,648, this comes from the hardware definition. So you have to look this up from the manual if you don't know this. And the normalizing function block scales this input to value between 0 and 1. It's a real value, and it's a value between 0 and 1. And what I have done here is that I've created a temporary variable in this OB1 block, and I've created LI100 norm as for normalized value. And I have picked that value in here. This hashtag means that this tag is defined as a temporary value in the OB1 block. So you cannot read this value from outside of the OB1 block, but it's okay because we only need this tag to connect the output of normalizing function block to the input of the scaling block. So you see, I use the same tag in these two places, meaning that I connect output to value input. And scaling, you give the minimum value of the scale and maximum value of the scale here. The scale is from 0 to 100, and the output is connected to a memory place, MD20 in this case. And I have given it the tag li100.me. Okay, so this is the way you can do the scaling yourself, but it's possible to use also the PID scaling that is internal to PID. If you do it this way, then this MD20 would be connected to the input of the PID control. Then the measurements and the set points are calculate, there's a difference calculation and you get an error value. There's deadband for hysteresis. Then there's gain, that's the P term. Then there's integration and differentiation. Integration is quite often used and differentiation is not that commonly used. So usually you leave this out. You only use integration. Give the parameter of integration time in the PID control. Select P and I terms in use. Error signal multiplied by P and integrated by TI integration time. They are calculated together. And then that signal is the output of the controller, but you can select whether you use that calculated output as the physical output, or you can also give manually an output value that is connected then to the physical output. And there's a bit that controls whether you use the manual value or the calculated value. In one sense, you could think of this manual control as a force control. So if you want to set the output of the PID controller to a certain value at certain time, then you switch the controller to manual control and you should have an appropriate value here as the manual value. So for example, if you control a valve and you want the valve to be totally shut at certain time, then you would put 0 in here and 1 in here so that it would select this manual value as the output, and the manual value that you have set would be 0, so that would put the valve in a closed position. Any time you want to change this, it's possible to change. If you have manual on signal on, then the output will follow the value that you write in here. Okay, and at some point you want the controller to take over, then you switch manual on signal to off. And then this switch will turn into this position and the output will follow the control calculation. The most common output scale is from 0 to 100. And this default for this element normalization is that the output will be scaled to 0 to 100. And there are two outputs from the controller. It's the control value or element. In this case, I can't recall what this is acronym of. But anyway, this is the real value analog output. And then there's a scaling for the analog output card signal from 0 to 27,648. So once again, you have the possibility to use the real value that is scaled from 0 to 100 and the integer scale value that can be connected straight to the QW80, which is the default address for analog output 0. You don't have any switch to select one of these. They both are in use all the time. Here you have to select which measurement you use for the calculation. But the output, they are both available all the time. I will take the function block for the controller. Now the function block controller has to be put in a cyclic interrupt. Don't put it in a program cycle. This program cycle is executed as fast as possible, and sometimes it is faster in its execution, sometimes it's a little bit slower. So the execution cycle varies. But when you take the cyclic interrupt, it will be executed in intervals that you're given here. The default is 100 milliseconds, and it's okay. So I will leave that cycle time as the default value. So when we use the cyclic interrupt, we will know that the function will be executed once every 100 milliseconds exactly. And PID control, as it's dependent on the execution time, you have to have it executed at regular intervals. And by the way, I'm not sure if I have showed you how to switch a programming language. So for example, I would like to use FPD for this function. So I change the programming language to FPD. And PID function block, it's not in basic instructions. Is it in extended instructions? No, it's in technology instructions. PID control, compact PID. And then we have three different versions. But please always use PID compact unless you have a specific reason for using anything else. Even if you have a temperature control, PID compact is meant to use with analog inputs and analog outputs. So I drag this PID compact in here. It will create a data block to store all the information it needs to remember between each execution cycle. And for example, I will set up an LIC100. I will give the tag name for this data block so it's easier to remember what belongs to which control loop. So DB1 is LIC100, so now you can nicely see that LIC100 is this PID controller. And if you look here in the system blocks, you have also this PID compact function block here. We don't actually need it, but it's nice to know that it isn't there. Okay, I will enlarge this PID compact to show more inputs and outputs. Set point. This is the value that the controller tries to have as its input by controlling the output. So this is the process value that you want the process to set into. For example, I have a level controller with the scale, for example, from 0 to 2 meters. The set point could be, for example, 1.6 meters. I can give it straight in here by typing in 1.6 and enter. Now the set point is fixed to 1.6. But if you have any need to change this set point value during the process, when the process is running, then you have to put a memory place in here. You have to define a tag for it. And I will do that also in here. I will create a tag called LIC100.sp, SP for set point. It will be a real value because the set point is always a real value. And I will comment that this is the mixing tank set point. And I will put the scale here, 0 to 2 meters. Just as for comment. And when I go back to cyclic interrupt, I will change this fixed set point to come from this tag value. Now, when you use a tag here as the set point, it's also possible to give this this value from the user interface. So you would connect this tag to the user interface value, and you could give this value from there. And sometimes it's required that you change the set point from the application. And you can do that by using a move function block. So if I create a new network here, I will drag a move function block. Move operations, move. And the output will be the set point memory place. So I'm changing the mixing tank set point according to a process value. Some binary bit perhaps telling that, okay, now we have to empty the tank, or we have to set the tank level to a certain point. So for example, if I would like to set the mixing tank set point to 1.6 at certain time, I would have to define, the condition for this move function block to activate and connect it to this enable input. You can create the application here, or you can create the application somewhere else and connect this enable input to a tag indicating that now it's the time to set the set point to 1.6. So I will just define a tag. Well, actually, I have created few tags: process starting, process stopping, process running. I could use, for example, this tag, process running. It's a boolean indicating the process is now in running status. I have three different process statuses. I have process starting, indicating that the startup sequence is running. Everything is not ready yet. Then everything will get ready. I will reset this and set this, indicating that process is now in normal running status. And when I would like to stop the process, I would reset this bit to zero and then set this bit process stopping, indicating that the stop sequence is running. How I would do it, that's a different story and I will not go into that, but I just have defined these bits so that I can use them in an application and define the action of these bits later. I don't have to think about that now. All I want to do is that when the process is running normally, I will force the set point to value of 1.6. And you may have recalled that I used the word force. By force, I mean that whenever this bit is 1, when the process is running, the move function blocks will copy this value to this memory place every time that this block is executed. And as this block is in OB1, which is executed as fast as possible, this value will be written in this memory place quite often, all the time. So it might be a good idea to change this to be sensitive only to the rising edge. So when there's a change in this value from 0 to 1, it would write this value in here. And after that, when this signal is static, when it's constantly 1, the move function block will not be active. And the user could change this value from the user interface. So how to change that to wait for the rising edge of the signal? Scan operand for positive edge. Signal edge. Okay, but what is the difference between the... Okay, I guess it's this one. Can I put it in here? Yes, I can. So I inserted a function block, scan operand for positive signal edge, meaning that it will check when there's a rising edge on this signal, meaning when this signal is changed, has changed from 0 to 1. Only then this output will be 1 for one execution cycle. What it needs a memory place to remember what has been the status on the previous execution cycle so that it can define whether there has been a rising edge or not. So you have to give a memory place for this, and it could be, well, I will add a tag here. This would be rising edge. Process start. It's not real, it's Boolean. Zero 0.5 is available. Or maybe it would be more clear if I say that process just started. That's the meaning of this signal. Okay, so whenever the process switches from not running to running, then the set point will be set to 1.6. So that's how you can do it. And you can have plenty of these move function blocks. And then you have to have different conditions when these move function blocks, different function blocks activate. And you have different values that will be set as the set point in different phases of the process. Then you have to select whether you use the real point, real type of input, measurement input, or you connect the analog input straight to this point. Did I have a tag for the analog input? No, I haven't done it yet. So I will create a tag called LI100, and that will be the IO tag, and it's going to be a word and the address. Well, if you can't remember what the address of the analog input is or should be, then you can, let me see, you can go in here, take device configuration. Properties, analog input, IO addresses, and you will see that the analog input addresses start from 64, and you can have a look on the individual analog input channel 0 is in address IW64, and channel 1 is in address IW66. You cannot change the addresses from here. If you want to change the addresses, you have to go in this field and change it here. But if you don't have any specific need to change the address, please let them be as the default. It makes my life a little bit easier when I check your projects when creating the course. Okay, so channel 0 is IW64, so I will give that to my analog input address. It's going to be an input, a word, type word, and 64 will be the address for the first analog input. And this will be the mixing tank level measurement from analog input 0. Yeah, channel 0, channel 1. Exactly. So the input would be coming from the peripheral, meaning the physical input, and I could select the input from here. And the same thing for the output, you can select which one you use. And the easier way to do this is, of course, use the analog output itself. I think I don't have a tag for that either. So I have to create LC100.io, which is in address. Let's see, what's the address? Analog output board, or the signal board for output, IO addresses, and channel 0, QW80. So Q for output, W for word, it cannot be changed, and 80 is the address for the analog output. This is mixing tank filling valve to valve control to AQ0. And now I can connect the peripheral output to LC100 output. You can leave N disconnected. This will mean that the PID compact is executed all the time. There's no reason to not execute the PID compact. If you want to force the output value to some specific value, you can set the controller to manual control. We will look at this a bit later. Then let's have a look on the configuration window. We have this toolbox symbol here. Click there. And we have some values that can be configured here. So the controller type. Mine is a level control or a volume control. Let's see, temperature, pressure, length, flow, brightness, illumination, force, torque, mass, current, voltage, power, area, volume. Let's see, volume. Well, I have meters, so I don't have a suitable value here, so I will take general and set the, can I set the, no, I cannot set that. Then I have to take length and then select meter. That's a little bit unfortunate. I don't invert control logic because I have a filling valve that is controlled and then the control is not inverted. If I would control the level of the tank with emptying valve, then I would invert the control logic. Activate mode after CPU restart, set mode to automatic. Well, this depends. This depends. You can figure it out yourself. Automatic or manual mode. Manual mode, of course, would be a little bit safer. Okay, let it be in manual mode. That's a little bit safe. Input output parameters. Set point is taken from... Can I select it? Okay, well, it's already set. In here, this is the set point, so I should not have to take care of it in here. But the selection of the measurement, you can select whether you use the analog input or the real value coming from some calculation. My controller uses the value straight from the analog input, so this is good for me. And the output, the same. I'm using the analog output, so I do not select any other than this. So that's okay. Process value settings. Siemens calls the measurement process value. So these are measurement settings. Process value, high limit, low limit, and scaling. Well, I put the scaling first. I said that my tank level is from 0 to 2 meters. So I will set it here. And I will not touch these values. These are the analog input hardware values, which are fixed, and I don't want to mess with this. Process value limits. This is if you want to have some kind of alarm coming from the hardware if you go over some limits. So I will put 1.2 here. That would be the hardware limit for the analog input. Process value monitoring, no. Output value limits from 0 to 100% is okay. PID parameters, enable manual entry if you want to set this manually, or if you are using automatic tuning, you can select PI control from here. PID is quite seldom used, so PI would be fine. And then we would use the tuning. But if you want to tune up the controller, then you have to have the process or the process simulation. So I don't have either at the moment, but I will create a simulation later. So I will use the automatic entry from the tuning function. Okay. Let's have a look on the parameter view. So quite a lot of parameters here, but I think you don't have to change anything in here. This is actually just a more accurate or elaborate view of the same thing. You have more parameters that you can see and change from here, but it's not usually necessary. What this display is good for is that you can put the glasses on. You can monitor these signals and parameters while you are testing the application. So this view might be needed at that point. So that's the basic configuration of the controller.